play that. We're gonna go on that solo. Just keep on
solo. Yes,
and I'm gonna start feeding back.
Yeah.
You just keep that thing. We'll get a trance. We'll get a trance going there, man. That's a 20-minute. That's a 20-minute motherfucker. The Waboritas are good today. They're good today, the Waboritas.
Shit, what else
are you doing? It's all reason I'm brother.
I got my first drum set when I was 15, on my 15th birthday, and we formed this band. For back then, for a garage band, it was a pretty involved band. So Sam, he auditioned for our band. How about that?
Yeah, he thinks he's a fucking master. What, are you out of gas already?
I have roast beef sandwich.
I love the guy. When we were kids, we could sit and listen to records together over and over again, like listen to an Eric Clapton solo, and, you know, whether we smoke pot or not, and just vibe it, connect on it, you know. He's like the brother I never had.
The drums are just the sound. It's a room. It ain't you.
The hook?
It ain't you. It's a fucking room, man.
It's your ceiling. I'll tell you what.
It's your ceiling.
That's a high compliment. The
first time I met Sammy was in the studio. And I guess they needed somebody to come in. They were remixing a song for a single. They needed somebody to come in, add some keyboard parts and some vocals.
You know what's weird? I'm feeling the chorus lyrics, which I'll go over with you. Can you sing them with me?
Yeah.
What I really think it was, you know, Sammy said, hey, check this guy out. If he's any good, then, you know, maybe I'll ask him to join my band. It was kind of like an audition in the studio. So I went in, played some keyboard parts, did some singing. And I remember Sam came by the second day I was there, and he had done some kind of interview, and he walked in and he was wearing all black leather, like black leather, you know, jacket and pants and everything. And it was a little intimidating, you know, he was all decked up and he had his rock star attitude.
All right, that's it. I'll see you guys at the airport. Hey, have you guys got together for the airport? What are you doing?
We got it together, don't worry.
You guys can work on it?
Don't worry about it.
Who'd I put in charge? Who'd they ask me? I said, bro, I think I put you in charge, bro.
Well, you know,
but it don't matter, so
I guess as long as I don't become Sarge or Jabba.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, if your fucking late ass is late like it always is,
me late?
I'll become Sarge on your ass.
I punctual Joe.
You know, going out on tour and all that has its ups and downs. You know, I hate getting up every morning and leaving. That's the worst thing, but
I'm a veteran, man. I know how to do this stuff, man. It's like I'm a road horse, man. Jump on me and ride. I'd rather be on stage playing than have a night off anytime. If your heart is in it, you got to do it. You got to do it. As long as they want to see you, as long as you still got it in you, go do it. I'd do it for free tomorrow. Yeah, you can just start that video.
Look out, you're gonna trip! Look out!
No, I'm on film right now. You know, I'm documenting this whole thing, yeah.
Is we're gonna find out what everybody's made of.
Okay, so John, we're gonna run through the set, we're gonna record it, tape it, everything, right? You know, the Sam and Dave tour, it started off, I never knew Dave, and I suspected from what everyone has always told me that he wasn't an easy guy to get along with, so. My idea was that maybe this would motivate a Van Halen reunion with the Sam and Dave tour with Van Halen, which I think still would be one of the greatest things Van Halen could ever do for the fans. And I thought, well, I'll go out there with Dave, do this little tour, and if it works, hey, cool.
Fuck, I just woke up, man. I can't be fucking running to a rock and roll set right now. I'm gonna hurt myself.
I hate to over-rehearse, because when you over-rehearse, you get all polished, and pretty soon you can do the show blindfolded. And when you can do the show blindfolded, then it becomes just kind of instincts, you know, you just go out there and just kind of go through the motions because you just don't do that. I like it when it's on the edge. I like up there, you know, for everyone to be looking around and watching each other for the cues, like, whoa, 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 keep everybody on their toes and edgy. Because, you know, if you know it all, you just go through it and it's done. Next song, you know, I'm
damn it all to hell. You guys are pissing me off already. I'm already fucking pissed off.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Red Rock.
This is called rehearsal.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Red Rocker and the Waboritas!
Do is a very it's a very, you know, strenuous show on everyone's voice. There's a lot of singing in my band, a lot of background singing. We play a long time. We play 2.5 hours sometimes.
You know, everybody's voice is tired after singing a 2-hour show. I mean, if you're not tired, then you're not giving it up, you know, that type of thing. But Sammy's is really resilient. He's been doing it a long time, and he's, you know, he's a trooper.
The guy's in tune with the music, and he's not jaded. He is still hungry to fucking write a song and play, you know. So that's a turn on. I feel very lucky to that we can still do this.
Okay. The first time I met Sammy, I was in the Bus Boys.
Sam said, man, I think I want to get like a black guitar player, a freaky guitar player. I don't want to just get another Eddie clone.
So he calls me up and he says, hey man, Sammy here, you know, and I'm like, I look at my wife.
Sam said, man, I'm even thinking I'd like to get a girl bass player. I'd like to make this band kind of, you know, like New World or something.
I was working in this machine shop, and this kid comes up and says, you got a phone call. And I walked over and he says, hey, this is Sammy Hagar. So he asked if I wanted to come up and audition, and I was like, of course I do.
So when I walked in there, I wanted the gig. I wanted it bad. I'm like, man, playing with Sammy would be great, you know?
When Vic walked in, this is kind of how I am. I like things to be neat and orderly. Well, the studio, there was stuff all over. And so I was kind of moving stuff around and making it real neat. So Vic comes walking in with his guitar, and he thought I was the maid. So anyway.
And man, I'll tell you what, there weren't a whole lot of auditions because it clicked like that, you know.
These are the two motherfuckers that is called gravity. They're making the world go around, all right?
There he is, the ugliest son of a bitch.
Oh, no, his wife.
That's a hurt. I'll take that as a compliment.
Ted comes and sees me on every tour because Ted and I are buddies. We kind of are cut from the same mold, you know? So we've always got along real good.
Ted needs 53 years clean and sober.
Enough already!
I got him drunk on Cabo Wabo that night, and he said Cabo Wabo's responsible for breaking his 51 years of sobriety.
The
Kid Rock just showed up to the show in Detroit in his red 60 Cadillac convertible.
Next thing you know, man, I'll be late for the gig.
Good in Detroit steel, don't I?
You know, Kid's a great guy. He's a rocker. You know, when he sings and performs, he's got a lot of attitude, and it's badass.
Motherfucking Sammy Hagar!
It's gonna be a rock.
Because we're here seeing Sammy.
It's been too long.
Hey, Sammy.
Kick-ass rock and roll party in the street.
Yeah. It's gonna be an awesome concert. It's a good ticket.
So we're here for the best concert of the season.
Definitely a good concert.
It's like buying a CD of the best of Van Halen.
But Sammy's a bigger show. That's why we're here tonight, man.
I always enjoy seeing Ted come out. He puts a smile on my face and vice versa, and we always jam. See, Ted's a musician. He puts on a guitar and says, let's go.
your tequila may help preserve me. I think that's what you're bringing to my life. Thank you for that.
For jumping up there cold like that, you were fucking ripping.
Cronova.
Yeah.
I respect my elders. I think
you and I. We know. No, you guys rock. You had a great feel. Sammy, you've never sang better. I mean that.
Yeah.
You start singing like that, I don't know what that is, but I'm going to start drinking that shit.
Well, that shit actually fucked up my voice a little bit because I did drink more than I normally do because I was there fucking around with the lime. I can't use the lime.
What about Kid Rock and David Lee Ross smoking, chain smoking?
Yeah, no, Rock, that's why.
Chain smoking!
That's why Rock can't sing. And Kid will be just like him if he ain't careful.
Chain smoking!
Somebody comes and gets us and says, kid's in there with David Lee Roth and he wants you come over there right now, man. He says, you got to come over there. I'm going, he's with Dave right now? I bring in a bottle of tequila. We start throwing down. And Kid Rock's going, you guys, you got to do it for the fans. He goes, I came here tonight wanting to see you guys get on stage and do a duet. You know, he goes, and you're letting us down. You're letting the fans, you know, really brought up a wonderful point, you know. And I said, absolutely right. I said, you're absolutely right. Let's talk to Dave. Dave's sitting there, he's going, well, sure, Sam, let's do something then. Yeah, he's right, you know. So Dave agrees. I'm going, all right. You know, the kid put it together. Thanks, kid, you're awesome. Dave the next night goes, oh, my throat's sore and I can't do it. I went over to see him and say, hey, you know, let's work something up. Or what do you want to do, you know? What song? And he backed out of it. And then the next night he backs out. So finally I became a running joke. I used to go beat on his dressing room and say, and he wouldn't even answer the door anymore. I'd be going, yo, Diamond, you ready tonight? You ready to go out and do it? You know, I kept a sense of humor about it.
This way, the big show.
Oh, it's fucking great, man. It's awesome. Wait to see this shit. It's a real rock and roll show, you know? Dave comes out with all his glitter and glamour and shit, and we come out with the real deal, and it just folds together as one big happy rock and roll event, you know?
Outstanding.
Great. You were fucking awesome.
Can I hear you through the wall like I hear you right off of a record?
But anyway, Michael Anthony's coming to Chicago, and he's going to come out and do all the Van Halen shit with me. And Roth is closing tomorrow night. Tonight I close. Tomorrow night he closes, so.
Great.
Go.
Happy. Superb.
I highly recommend you coming and seeing a really good ass whipping in person. All right, man. I'll see you there. Thanks, Josh. Bye.
Dave,
hell
took you so long.
Bring back memories.
So I got on the phone and said, Sam, you want me to come up and jam with you guys? I'll come up and play. You know.
I'm filming this. MTV's here and all this shit. Here you go, man. Just say hi to him. Say hey.
Because I just wanted to get up. I just wanted to get out and play.
Having Mikey out here, you know, Mikey's he's a real pleasure to have around. Everybody asks, well, what's it like? You know, geez, is it bumming out to have Mikey around? It's like, no, he's a great guy. He's a good player. He's out there having the time of his life. I jump out there and sing with him or, you know, beat on a tambourine or something. And, you know, we clown around. It's been a lot of fun.
I never have had an ovation, even when it's an evening with Sammy Hagar, you know, and there's 18,000, they don't respond the way they do when he walks out in the middle of our show.
3 years since I've done that. I'm gassed.
I got gassed so fast up there, you son of a bitch. You came out and gassed me. Got me all fucking just, you know, wore the people out. See him.
Well, Mike and I have always been great friends. And I think the reason he didn't try to side with me during the breakup, you know, when Ed and Al were out to crucify me, they had already got Mike and basically threatened him, you know, you make one false move and you're out. So I think Mike just was smart enough to pull his head back off the chopping block, you know what I mean? It's kind of like, I was still friends with him because I actually understood.
When you told Eddie you were going out with Sammy and you know.
It didn't get, well, actually with Sammy, they didn't have a big problem with it. That's when I told him, I said, I just want to go out and play and have some fun. And Sammy, you know, we've always connected on a level, like, I don't know.
We know how to have fun.
It's like
fun.
The Two Stooges or something, man. You know, I'm just so jacked up just to come out there and play with these guys. It's great.
It's a ball. My bass player Mona, she loves Mike, man. You know, they're just they get
we've
along
become,
so
we've
good.
Become, we've become, we've become good.
I read an interview. You said the Mona would probably clock Dave if he started. And he would, and
she keeps that. Threatening. Because, man, the other night I did something. I said something in a New York newspaper that made Dave mad, and. His manager was threatening he was going to beat me up, you know, when I got off my plane. Where's this plane landed? I'm going to go, you know, I'm going to go beat him up. And Mona says, that's right, you fight him. She goes, and I'll kick Dave's ass. So, you know, that's right. The kind of thing we got going on. Right, it's a little rivalry, but it's rivalry is good for the fans. There's no rivalry in the audience. There's no people heckling Dave.
You're right, man.
Heckling me. Yeah. They're happy, man. They're getting to see an awesome rock and roll show.
I feel more like a worker than a star. You know what I mean? I feel like it's more like a job. And I don't mean that in a negative. I mean that very positively. I don't go out and snoot my audience and say, I'm a star, you know, I'm a big rock star. That's a bunch of crap. I don't feel like that anymore at all.
That's the biggest comment I get is the interaction of the band with the audience. And it's fun, you know, I mean, why shouldn't you have fun? As much fun with them as you want them to have with you, you know?
The people that are your fans, they want that connection. I like that, that's what he does, you know, we share this.
You're not gonna care about those people? There's no way I could even do that. I have to care about those people. In my heart, I was raised that way, man. It's like, you know, you spend your hard-earned cash, you need some bang for that buck, and I just feel like I have to do that. I'm obligated. I have to get up if I'm tired, my back hurts, and my throat's a little scratchy from touring so much, I get it up.
You know, the crazy thing when you're out there on the road for so long, especially me, because I'm so busy. I'm doing interviews. I'm waking up in the morning. I'm looking at my schedule. See what time I got to leave. I got my family. I got my kids helping car. You know, pack up. You know, and you know, you just forget about it. Pretty soon, there's people that are hired to do a lot for you.
You getting any of this shit? He left me behind. The special guest star of the tour, right here.
It's crazy, man. We left Mikey behind. See, Mikey's not really in the band. He just kind of, he's kind of hanging out with the band. So, like, you forget, you know?
Right here, we get your saddle up sheet. See, this is what, you know, they give them. For me, it's the left, get left behind sheet.
The nice.
All right, shoot me.
How long?
It's all me.
My bad, yeah.
And we had to stop the plane and wait for him. It was pretty funny. And he felt bad. I mean, he really felt like, wow, man, I came all the way out here and you guys don't even appreciate me. But it wasn't like that. It was pretty funny.
Hey!
Hey, Sammy.
Yeah. Come on, girl. I don't know what I've been living on, but it's not enough to fill me up. I need more than just what words can say. I need everything this life can give me. Hey, hey, yeah. We looking like a concert. Looking like a concert, bunch of concert folk right there. Look at them. Them concert folk.
They know it's starting in 5 minutes or not.
Them's concert folk. When you see a Tesla and a Kiss shirt, when you see a Kiss shirt, that guy's here to see Roth. When you see a Kiss shirt, that guy's here to see Roth. He ain't here to see me. I guarantee you. There ain't no mixing up me with Kiss, okay? There ain't no mixing. Nothing wrong with Kiss. It just, you can't mix those two up. Roth, he kind of falls into that category. Costumes, you know, wigs, costumes, spray paint.
I got Randy Savage over in my office.
Who?
Get down, he's my
Savage
favorite.
Man.
Is he here? Oh, where is he? Mikey, come on, let's go see him right now. Come on, where is he? We gotta go straight with the cameras. Bring the cameras. Follow me. Come on, Andy. How are you?
Good.
See
you. Good.
Do you remember when we met in Van Halen years ago?
Absolutely.
Michael Anthony's with me again.
That's my one.
In this room, I'm watching everything I do, all right?
It's 5150.
Fill me up.
say. I need everything this life could give. Just let the magic do the work for you. Just honey, something, please stop and touch me.
We going to the bar?
You and me?
Oh, shit. Ain't nobody.
You and bro and that knucklehead last night?
Yeah.
Wait, are you guys crazy? We got a day off tomorrow. You guys can't be getting fucked up. We got a day off.
Reach down between my legs. Ease the seat back. Flush the toilet.
Buddy, marry me.
Wabo, marry me.
Nice. I can't tour without my family anymore. And they come out. It's like, it's awesome. I mean, you know, I've been out there 4 or 5 days without them, and I see them. It's like, oh, this is what it's all about. What I've done with Kari and Kayman and Samantha's, you know, they come with me. It's plain and simple, you know, and those are my priorities.
We had a really interesting first meeting, because when Van Halen came to town, this promoter who was our friend and said, hey, there's a birthday party and they're in town on their day off, and why don't you bring your girlfriends down. And anyway, we walked into this birthday party, and we immediately hit it off. We started talking, and later that night there was a beauty bimbo contest, whatever you want to call it. And Eddie and Sam had said that they were going to go over and go judge this, you know. And Eddie had too much to drink. And so he said, why don't you come over there with me? You probably, have a better view on this anyway, you know. So I went over and we judged this contest together, which was kind of fun and controversial, it was just neat. Then the next night was the concert, and they had to go to another town the next day, and I had something else to do, and he said, can't you come to that show? And I said, well, no, not really. And he said, here's my tour manager's cell phone. He said, call me, and he said, and I'll send the plane back for you. I caught it, and then I went to the show, and when I got there, I went on the side of the stage, and it was like, honest to gosh, when in the middle of like whatever he was doing, I mean, he didn't stop the song, but it was like, he completely just gave all the attention to me over on the side of the stage, and as soon as that song ended, he literally ran off stage and just gave me this big hug and a kiss, and it was like, it was amazing. So
you went out on all the tours?
Went out on all the tours. Traveled all the places, saw all the shows. Actually, you know, I still travel all the places. I don't get to see as many shows, but I'm seeing still like 80% of them. I mean, I'm not seeing them all because I'm with the kids. I'm not going to drag the kids out, you know, from the hotel. But Daddy still, you know, goes out for 2-3 hours and he's home.
The main thing about this band is that we really do like each other. We really get along good. It's not just the music. We've grown to be a family. And I guess the real truth is yes, we just do, if there's a thing that's a gathering area, a beach, we'll all be there. And we like each other. As crazy as it is, we actually like each other. It's funny.
Who's winning?
We are. The rhythm section. The rhythm section.
Spike. We call him Spike.
That's all right, Joanne. It's your turn.
I really think I'm a perfect combination of my mom and dad. I think I got the humble side, the I'm not better than anyone, accepting life is just kind of the way it is, easygoing thing from my mom. And I think I got my drive and I'm going to be somebody and I am, you know, something special. You know, I got all that from my dad.
I don't think anybody that we know can really match, you know, how Sam's childhood was. You know, he grew up, you know, pretty much dirt poor with a alcoholic dad who was, you know, scary, violent, kind of.
It was awful to see a person that had all this potential do nothing with it, do nothing but destroy the family that he loved.
His mom had to swoop them up and, you know, find chicken coops to, you know, sleep in.
She'd pack us up and go. You know, he'd come home drunk and she'd go out the back door with us and hop in the car. I remember we had an old 36 Chevy. And she'd get in that and we'd go. You know, if we had to live in the car, we'd live in the car.
The first time I heard him sing, he had a little room out in the back of my house. And at first he wanted an instrument. And I was supporting the kids all by myself, and it wasn't easy. And so I says, okay, what do you want? And he said he wanted drums. And to this day, I'm glad I didn't get him drums. I said, Sam, they're too expensive and too loud. So he says, okay, a guitar.
He says, I'm going to be determined. I am going to show you.
And I see a whole lot of that is Dad. Dad in a boxing ring was never knocked down, ever. He never quit. He would fight till he was bloody and dead. He wouldn't have quit. And it's a great gift, that tenacity and that guts where you stand there and take it until you can do it.
And that determination carried on to my dad, you know? I mean, like, he's got a lot of will, a lot of spirit, and that's what's, you know, got him where he is today.
I know he's famous and what, but he's my baby, and I feel the same towards him as I do all of them. You know, it's like putting money in the bank. You sacrifice for something, and you reap it later. And that's what it means to me.
This is why Sammy's still in the business, because of his mom. Look at this.
This is
mom,
the
you
jeans.
Look beautiful. You look great.
Between, you know, his mom and his dad, I think that's where he gets all that energy from. But he's an entertainer, period. He loves it. You can just see it. When he gets on stage, it's over. Sunday morning, 9 a.m. I saw fire in the sky.
When I breathe the air.
places. Take me away. Fly me away. Lift me up so high where eagles fly. Well, now I'm alive when I breathe the air. A glimpse of another dream. As I turned, I looked. I turned and looked again. I see no trace. Take me away. Fly me away. I wanna fly. Lift me up so high. Yeah, baby. Oh, hell yes.
You can only tour so long, you know. You go out on tour, a singer, you know, it's not just my voice, it's your physical body, it's your enthusiasm, and if you lose all that, then you start putting on these kind of shows that are going through the motions, and I don't do that.
So we take breaks, and when I take breaks, I like nothing more than coming home, walking through my front door, shutting it behind me, and I start cooking. I go right to the refrigerator, man, and I start pulling out. I love to cook. It just brings me back to normal.
And I miss it on the road, because, you know, I get rusty. You know, I'll come back from a two-month tour, and I'll walk into my kitchen, and where's the pot? Where's this and that? Well, what do I need? Oh, geez, you know. And then you start messing. You make a dish, and you're going, oh, man, I forgot to put this, you know, the parsley in it or whatever, you know. And it's one of my favorite things. It's just something that heals me and brings me back. And when I spend 2 weeks, 10 days, whatever the break is, sometimes it's 3 weeks, and I've done, I never go out to dinner during that time. Because I know in 3 more weeks I'm going to be eating room service again. So,
but I really dig it. Otherwise, I wouldn't be doing this. I love it. I love cooking. And after I'm calmed down with that a few days, then I go mess with my cars. I go to my warehouse and I look at my cars. And I start looking at them and I start checking them. I say, oh, I think I want to drive this one. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. There's Sammy's fleet. Now do you see why I'm happy? Look at this. How could anybody not walk in here and smile? 72 Daytona. Got about 20,000 miles on it is all. It's was the world's fastest car when it came out. Look how clean this thing is. It's my 55 T-Bird. Kari bought me this for my birthday last year. This is a little 59 Alpha Spider. It's kind of a little race car. 400i, you know, my four-seater Ferrari. You know, you put the kids in the back seat, turn on the air conditioning, turn the stereo on, roll the windows up, drive 155 miles an hour down the highway with your wife and two kids in the back, listening to music in an air-conditioned car. What other Ferraris like that but that? That was the first one that could do that. 512 Boxer, we all know this, the I Can't Drive 55 model. This is him right here. Here's my I Can't Drive 55 car. Look at this seat. It tells you everything right there. That seat is wore out from me being in and out of this car. I've driven this car, how many miles you got? 43,000 miles in this car. It's an 83. But you think about that. A car like this with that many miles, I used to drive it every day. But these two cars are about equal in speed from 0 to 60 in top speed. They're both about 180 miles an hour, about 4.5 seconds, 0 to 60s. This is only 138 miles an hour top speed because of the way it's geared, but it does it in 10 seconds. And then it doesn't stop after that. Then you got to work on trying to slow it down. You practically need a parachute, but I don't know. What do you think, Phyllis? Go for a ride. I've always driven like a complete jerk, complete asshole, always going so fast that I would tailgate people and I would just cut people off. I don't do it anymore. I drive fast, but I don't drive crazy like that. You know, when I'm driving around with my little girl in the back seat of my car in a car seat, and some guy does that, he's look, you know, he's been close to an ass kicking. That's called growing up. I get a lot of songs for ideas when I'm driving cars. Of course, obviously, I Can't Drive 55 was written in a car, but so many of my songs, I get the idea in my head. Most of the time, I don't listen to radio. You look at my radio, it's not in here. I had it ripped out. I don't listen to music in cars, very seldom. I like the sound of the engine. I like the smell of the gas. I like the smell of the burning oil. Your buddies back there.
Can't take a left handed turn.
Oh, he did.
Jesus Christ. I can't drive 55. I can't drive 55.
Uh-oh. Hey, we got trouble. Here we go. A fucking Chevelle. Okay, pal, let's go. Here we go. Get out of our way, folks. Get clear the road here, man. Clear the road. Give me an opening. Watch me lose this motherfucker. This car, nothing can touch this car in the street. Nothing. It's all good.
I was a little beat up this morning.
Amen.
Yeah.
Not hungover, none of that shit. Just flat fucking beat up.
It's all five shows in 6 days, man.
If I pay 100,
I don't think
I
ever quite got up.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, occasionally.
You know, I kind of got up, but then not really, you know.
But
Is
that Diamond's bus?
That car was fucked up.
They just hit now?
That car is fucked up. All right? That car is fucked up.
Yeah, baby.
We got everybody?
My brother. Whose bus is that if they're smashing up against a car?
Oh, they're smashing up against a car?
Yeah,
it's
a car. It's a car buried
inside the car.
Hey, you know what? I got good news for everybody. Guess what? There is such a thing as karma, and there is such a thing as God.
Right on.
That's his bus. That's
his and bus. It came a knocking.
Nice. Oh.
What?
Came a knocking on the Diamond bus.
The tour was living up to its name at that point. You know, there were tensions, and you know, the way Sammy does a show, I mean, it's kind of hard to follow that, you know. And when Dave had to come out and, you know, I mean, I don't like to talk bad about anything, but you know, it's like he had his work cut out for him. And I think tensions started to run a little a little high.
Anyway, everybody see the reviews?
I got more than one?
Oh, I got off the internet. VH1 reviewed the show.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that. VH1.
Awesome shit, man.
Launch.com, right? That's what
yep. Else. All kinds of these. I guess they sent every fucking. Yeah, I mean, there's. I got at least 8. I got them in my bag right there. Give me everybody. Awesome. Every one of them, hands down. This was just sent to me from Kansas City a few nights ago. It said, results in. Van Hagar wins. Hagar is all about having a blast and being delighted that his audience is there to be part of it. Roth just wants you to look at him as though he's still the king of MTV. Hagar's out there rocking people's socks off. Ross just trying to pull this off.
That's good. Ross just, oh, I didn't get that. That's good.
Joining Hagar on this tour is Van Halen bassist Michael Anthony, looking like he's having more fun than he's had since the Van Halen brothers unceremoniously booted Hagar from the band. They'll be sorry if they're not already. But when they attack such standards as Top of the World right now, Best of Both Worlds, Why Can't This Be Love, and Finish What You Started, there was no effort to recreate Van Halen. Right on. Roth, on the other hand, has nothing else he can do. Fronting what can only be described as an unremarkable Van Halen tribute band, Roth, decked out in bleached hair and blue metallic spandex, attempted a journey back to pre-1984. While not berating his sound man or telling his eager young band members where to stand, late in his set, Roth ill-advisedly and abetted by ego appeared with an acoustic guitar for Ice Cream Man, demonstrating in one more way that another sort of David Lee Roth unplugged might be a very good idea.
What the hell did he mean by that?
He means like unplug, I mean like unplug him for good.
Oh, just good.
I think you could be right. Okay, this guy doesn't like Dave. I'm glad I just got this review. Thank God it wasn't a bad one for me. Van Halen may be the rock band of your youth, but Friday night, Sammy made it clear that Van Hagar was truly the better band. Fortunately for him, he has more than those laurels on which to rest. Lord have mercy. Sorry, Dave, but that's been the way it's been going on the whole tour, and that's as it should be. I'm glad this guy made it to the show and actually saw what he saw and wrote about it, because anybody in their right man's mind sees the same thing and writes about it the same way.
Dad and Eddie were just, the inspiration in that room was heavy. They were tight. They were great friends. I still think they would be if they dropped all the baggage.
Hey, I'm sorry, Eddie! Girls gone wild!
Waitress! Waitress! Waitress!
Waitress, I need a drink!
I just was in L.A. last weekend. We drove out past the Malibu house and to see my old house, which is next door. And Eddie's car was there. I mean, I don't know if he's driving that car or what, but yeah, I was tripping. I'm going, whoa, what if Eddie came out? I thought, what if he walked out? I would stop and get out and say, Edward, what up, you know? It's almost like that's how I have to run into him. Because if I make the call, it could turn sour. If he calls me, I'm going to be suspicious, and I'm going to be uppity and say, hey, well, look, if you want to get together and just be friends, say, well, you know, I'm going to have my restrictions, you know, and so it could go sour. But if we just ran into each other, it could either turn into a fist fight or it could be like a legitimate
good vibes and hugs and, wow, let's get together. Oh, man. You know, exactly. I think it has to be that way. Someone has to manipulate that. That we have to, you know, make that happen. Because it's inevitable.
Okay.
I really appreciate it. What's going on is we came up with the idea to build this guitar.
Oh, it's awesome.
We're donating all the proceeds, 100% of the proceeds to charity.
This thing is gorgeous, man.
Here you go.
It's really, really fucking cool. Who made it? What is it?
We did. My brother and I.
Man, that's great sound. God bless
him. It's all mother of pearl, hand inlaid.
What is it, tape, man?
25.
Thank you, Sam.
You're welcome.
I appreciate it.
Here, I gotta go with this set list real quick. Here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna go red.
We have a set.
Top of the world.
I don't know if you know about this, but sometimes it'll just change right there at spur of the moment, right there.
Yeah.
He'll go, no, let's don't do that, you know. He'll come over while I'm playing and say, you know, scream in my ear, you know, the music's like 100 and whatever dB. And I'm like, what'd you say? And he's like, let's play this instead. You know, instead of playing Top of the World, we're going to play, you know, Red or whatever.
Yeah.
Just out of nowhere, you know. So you got to, like, be watching it.
Sometimes he'll even take a song and make it into something completely different right there. And I think it's neat that he is comfortable with us as a band to do that.
We just keep it loose. Keep it fresh. And the second I get tired of singing a song, it's out. So many bands put a show together and go out and do 100 dates, the same exact show every night. I couldn't do that. I would just soon be pushing a broom, sweeping the same floor every night. It'd be the same thing to me.
2, 3, 4!
We'll be right back.
was a good party, huh? Nobody lying to nobody up there, see? That's the difference between our band and most bands. Nobody was lying to anybody up there. You know what I mean, Mike?
I say you guys rocked the world.
But nobody was lying to anybody. But, you know, you just came out, right. You know, hey. Lying to nobody about nothing.
You take it right from the backstage to on stage.
You know, I think a lot of people have lost their competitive edge over the years. You know, they get satisfied. They say, I got the money, you know. You know, and they soften up, or they get distracted by playing golf or whatever. You know, it's really amazing how Sammy is probably interested in a lot of the same things now that he was 20 years ago.
When I'm with Sam, getting chills here, backstage or in a studio or on stage, there are many moments, and I live for these moments, where still those kids in that garage in San Bernardino trying to play as good as Jimi Hendrix or the Cream, or just trying to really make art and no bullshit. We haven't lost touch with that.
He really encourages everybody in the band to be themselves. You know, I can pretty much dress how I want to dress, act the way I want to act, and play what I want to play, and what could get better than that? Travel around with a bunch of people that, you know, that you're friends with, and see some things you never got to see before. I mean, it's been a great ride.
You know, I know it's not gonna last forever, you know, but I'm glad I was a chosen one to come here and hang out with the guy until whenever he wants to finish up doing it. Of course, I don't think he'll ever be finished, completely finished doing this stuff, you know.
I mean, he'll finish when they put him in a box.
Yeah, you know.
Until one of these members quit or something on me, you know, this is my band for the rest of my life. I love the Wabos. I mean, we're so happy together, I can't tell you. We are so functional. I don't crack a whip in my band. You know, any of this footage you see backstage of my band, there's no whip cracking. They're on it. Sometimes they're ahead of me. Sometimes they inspire me to get, you know, to get it up a little bit. When it's time to go, the bell rings, we are prepared. We are sweating already. You know, our voices are warmed up. I can hit any note I can hit the whole night. You know, and I got that nice little clean buzz from a shot of tequila, and we hit on a high. It's all hitting at the same time. If it doesn't all hit and peak at the same time, then, you know, it doesn't work.
I love this shit!
Don't talk much about
was setting up the second leg of the Sam and Dave tour, it just happened to, because we rolled it over, you know, I closed the last show and I opened, so I had to open the first show of the tour type thing. So we just rolled it right straight through, and the way it came out, the way it was booked, I got New York. And it was the day of the MTV Music Awards, so I called my manager, Irving Azoff, said, hey, see if they'll let Sam and Dave give away an award. Dave's manager calls, my manager, 10 o'clock night, said, okay, Dave will do it if he closes. I hit the ceiling. I'm going, why would I let him close when it's not his turn? And I just said, I'll do a free show in New York. I'm gonna play New York. So I just did a free show. I said, you know, fuck him. That's it, I'm done with this guy. And it was gonna be the last show of the tour, so I wanted to have a party in New York.
This is for the MTV interview. Do you have five favorite videos?
Yeah, Tool,
and then something really stupid like Britney Spears.
Hey, you know, matter of fact, why don't you just pick all the finest, sexiest girl videos, and that's what I'll put. And I'll put Tool in there. Tool, I'm serious. No, come on, that's twisted. You have to make it.
My condolences go out to you.
No, here's the deal. David Lee Roth has finally had an influence on me, okay? Now I know you got to do something outrageous. And this guy, he does hopeless, outrageous things, right? But so I'm getting smart and I'm going, geez, if I did half the crazy shit he did with my talent and my likableness.
Oh, God, hey. Would you please shut up? I need to get in the car.
I love it. I think Brittany I did it again. I think the little schoolgirl out
there. There you go. See, now you're thinking like me. Go ahead, bite the Big Apple. Never mind the maggots. Can't give it away on Fifth Avenue. Flatter.
The stomach, yeah.
Oh, that's the Stones, man. My man Mick. Quoting my man Mick. Mm-hmm. Here we go.
What's happening? How you doing? Here we are backstage. The MTV 2002 Awards. And I get to be with Sammy Hagar. And I'm going to be David Lee Roth.
Look at all the people here tonight. Relax, Dave. They're not all here to see you, pal. Relax, it's good to see you, Dave. After 40 shows later, it's good to finally see you in person. Now, where you been hiding, pal? Well, we don't agree on everything, that's for sure, but we probably agree that, Dave, you could probably single-handedly kick all of these people's asses.
So, let me practice my lines. Relax, Dave. All these people aren't here just to see you. All right, no, it's like, all right, Dave, calm down. All these people aren't here to see you.
Not just to see you.
Yeah, all these people. No, everyone here.
No,
see, you guys are
here.
Fucking me up.
Everybody's not here to see you.
Yeah, everyone's not here
just to see you.
Good to see you after 55 shows. So, you know, what have you been doing all summer? Then he's going to say his line. I'm going to say, well, Dave, we don't agree on everything. But one thing I do agree with, and that's it, in your day, you could have kicked all these people's asses that are up for Best Rock Video of the Year. Ladies and gentlemen, in your day. Because as soon as I do my award, we'll be gone in 10 minutes after that. That was the craziest shit I've ever done in my life. For not winning an award, I did more fucking press than when I won an award in the old days. When Van Halen won 100 awards, I did more press tonight and I didn't win shit. I just hope I can sing tonight. My voice is shot. I mean, just not from
I can tell.
Not from the interviews.
I can just tear it. I can tell.
I got a sore throat. I mean, if I'm just not going like that.
Drink lots of Coke.
So I said, I'm just going to play a free concert at Irving Plaza, 1,000 tickets, and I'm going to give, you know, 500 to the Port Authority and the police department, and 500, you know, on the radio to give away to some of my New York fans. First come, first serve, you know.
Well, Sammy, we wanted to give you this on behalf of the New York City Fire Department, all the brothers. When we heard you were coming to town, there was only one thing we wanted to do, is just say thank you. And let me read it to you. It's presented to Sammy Red Rocker Hagar and the Waboritas in appreciation for your support, generosity, and tribute to our fallen brothers. Your friendship and fine music has brought great comfort in the aftermath of September 11, 2001. Please accept our eternal thanks, the New York City Firefighters.
Oh, man.
Thank you, bro.
Yeah, Sammy!
Sammy!
That's awesome.
Thank you so much.
We want to thank God for blessings, for the love and the light, for allowing the love and the light to pass through us and touch all those we come into contact with. We want to thank God for this wonderful opportunity to bring love and joy to all these people here tonight, and for the ability to do a perfect job.
I am the resurrection and the life. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the resurrection and the life.
Mr. Gary Sharon, when is this? See, you thought it was impossible you'd ever see Sam and Dave together, but seeing Sam and Gary is even crazy.
He welcomed me into his family. Unbelievable. That's about the bottom is backstage. He rocks. He's the real deal. I love you, Sam.
In a fucking police cop shirt on stage smoking pot, smoking two buds at once, right? I think that maybe it might have been the loosest. It's just like Cabo Wabo.
Plaque. And then I think it was Brian from the United States. He said, I want to give him my fucking shirt. You know what? And I said, Brian, go up there right now. Just go up there and give him the shirt.
You gonna cry?
Yeah. Mike, how about those two big guys?
We got it going on. It's like
how about those big old guys?
It's like if we were a young band, people would be going, these
no, I ain't coming.
You know what I mean? Right? I mean, you know what I mean? It's like the old days, you know? It's the same shit on some other level, though. You know, yeah, it's the same intensity.
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
Exactly.
We need a hit. Help me, Mike. Help me write a hit, will you?
Just need to get Beavis and Butthead on board.
that's
a hit, and you know what?
Oh, we're talking about pew!
Game over. That's what you're talking about.
Maui, oh, we'll sell Maui. We'll find another island. Yeah. We'll call it Halen.
That's right.
We'll call it Halen. Halen Island.
Fucking island.
Halen.
You take one corner, I'll take
they
the other end out.
That's right.
They
the tour itself, in hindsight, was awesome. You know, it could have been friendlier, it would have been nice, but sometimes, you know, the edge made it a little edgy, and it made me want to kick his ass every night, which I went out to do. You know, the crew got real close because everyone was so, you know, we had a lot of guys that worked for Dave and me. We sat around and talked about the blues. Oh, man, wouldn't this be great if it could be like this or like that? In the end, it was kind of sad seeing it end, you know, because it was a big-time tour. In my life, you know, after you've accomplished, you know, a lot of success, and I don't mean that in a bragging sense, but everything that you call success, you know, sold millions of records, I've sold out every building in the world, I've been, you know, on the cover of all the major magazines, all the things that you think you want growing up and starting. Well, I went way beyond anything I was expecting. And you get all those things, and then you realize that really isn't satisfying you completely.
It's not about getting a goal and accomplishing it, because that in the end isn't really going to make you happy. The things that make you happy, whether it just be in the kitchen cooking or in the garden gardening or I don't know, you know, whatever makes you happy, you need to do more of that in your life. And, you know, I'm fortunate to have a job that happens to make me happy. You know, so many people are so goal-oriented and they're just looking at the ending, getting to that goal as fast as they can and getting what they want. And it's really not about that. I mean, the ending isn't where it's at all. It's the journey that's where it's at. I mean, after everything I've accomplished, every goal I've set that I've reached, I don't know, I think I'm happier just that I'm still on that long road to Cabo.
Thank you.
produced by, directed by, written by, starred in, Sammy Hagar, my name and lights, yeah, camera work, DP, all of it. And take all the credit, unless it bombs. If it bombs, oh. Gil, how are you going to put all this into an hour and a half? We're going to have about 152 days of film.
Jeez, I mean, all right. I'm interested.
You know, nobody hears around here. They're all fucking deaf.
What? Looks like the diamond's got his eyes a little crossed up there. Now, like,
you can eat cheese or anything with this shit.
This is who I am. You make sure you get it on film and have the sound going, too. What I believe.
Action!
Hey, don't. You can't film that.
Lame.
Earlier, did I have a booger hanging out of my nose?
Yes, big one. Are my eyes crossed? That's what he's doing.
Oh, I
can't even believe it. See why I hate these things?
Damn, that was a good drink.
It's as simple as it gets. Oh, this is who I am. You documented this?
You know, I know the whole story.
Nobody over here.
Completely true.
This is funny.
Oh, Sam, what do you think?
This is why I like to wear the Sammy
Hagar. Are you married?
You're killing me.
I dig myself a hole
here. He hounds me. He just harasses me all the time.
Wait.
Break it up.
Oh, no, you don't. Oh, shit.
You want some of this?
Yes, I'd love to fight, and I could beat any man in the world.
No, get it. Hold his back. I'll get his ass. Hold that.
I was tired last night, and tonight I'm retired. I'm about ready to kill you, Byron.
Who needs continuity anyway?
I really don't know.
Yeah, exactly. Hey, Mike.
Look out, big. Look out. Yeah.
Oh, Seamus is back.
Man, excuse the hell out of me. I'm allergic to cameras.
Quiet.
You take the money, Dave. That's what you're doing. You're taking the money.
Damn, I said that pretty well, didn't I?
You guys are gonna be locked in with Sammy Hagar. It's dangerous business. Ha ha ha!
You guys just. Yeah!